The Crusades. Why are we talking about the Crusades? The Crusades are, and these are the other lectures that are coming up. Tomorrow I'll talk about faith and culture in the ancient Near East and the birthplace of empires. Okay? I forgot that slide was there. The Crusades. Why are we talking about the Crusades right now particularly? The Crusades are a critical time in the history both of Western Europe and of the Middle East, the ancient Near East. And yet, it is a period of time in which very few people know very much, and what they think they know, in most cases, is wrong. So today, we're going to talk about what the cause for the Crusades were, causes, multiple, what actually happened during the Crusades, and what the results of the Crusades were. So we're going to talk about all of that. Even though this happened 700 years ago, 600 to 700 years ago, there still are very strong feelings about this. You may remember, after 9/11, President George W. Bush announced that there was going to be a crusade against terrorism. His very use of the word crusade ignited protests from all over the world, because the view that people had that crusade meant a conflict of civilizations and meant oppression. And yet, on the other hand, the word crusade to many people means a commitment of dedicated focus to achieve a good cause. So the very word crusade has a lot of baggage, both negative and positive, to it. And so we want to talk about all that today. In terms of what the Crusades were, you'll notice the dates I have up here, 1095 to 1291. In the 11th century AD, and I'm going to read this to you in case you're folks in the back, you know, the tree people back there can't see it. In the 11th century AD, Islamic forces of the Muslim Seljuk Turks, and I'm going to tell you who the Seljuk Turks were shortly, defeated the armies of the Christian Byzantine Empire, and I'll tell you what the Byzantine Empire was, cut off Christian access to holy sites in and around Jerusalem, and threatened to overrun all of Asia Minor and through the Iberian Peninsula, that is through Spain and Portugal, to overrun all Western Europe. In response to this, and to pleas for help from the Eastern Emperor in Constantinople, Christian Western Europe launched almost two centuries of military campaigns to free the Holy Land from Muslim control. Right, that's just a definition. I'm going to explain how we got to that as we go along. I will mention that the word crusade itself comes from a French word which means to take up the cross. In fact, if you study the history, it will often say that St. Louis took up the cross. What that meant was committed himself to join a crusade. And some of the characters, like King Richard the Lionheart of England, took up the cross, meaning he became a crusader. And again, that word, that very word crusader, has both positive and negative meanings to a lot of people. The Crusades were a holy war, if you will, in the sense that they were fought on behalf of a particular faith, that is Christianity. But it's way more complex than just Christians versus Muslims. There were a lot of political issues involved in it, and it's much more complex than what a lot of people think, and this is the misunderstanding most people think, is that it was just a product of religious prejudice. It was Christians who wanted to, you know, get rid of the Muslims. Much more complicated, as always is. I was asked the question before we started, that one of the guides, apparently, I guess yesterday, said that Eastern Orthodoxy was the one true church and that Roman Catholicism messed it up and they went their own direction. Well, that's what an Eastern Orthodox person would say, but if you ask a Roman Catholic, they'd have a very different idea about what happened there. So in every case, and there are political issues as well as theological issues, the same thing is true with the Crusades. A lot of it depends on what perspective you're coming from, and the issues are very much more complicated than most people realize. In effect, the Crusades were a fascinating and complex combination of devotional, that is Christian devotional pilgrimages, and military campaigns. Because there was a devotional aspect. Some of the Crusaders, when they traveled to the Holy Land, like the First Crusade, when they conquered Jerusalem and some of the other cities, they spent an enormous amount of time wandering around to the various religious sites, because for them this was a pilgrimage as much as it was a military campaign. So let's talk about the causes of the Crusades right now. I want to give you a map to start out. This is the state of Christianity, and I think I showed this to you in the introduction, in 565 AD, and that date, that approximate date, the late 6th century, is very important. One, I want you to notice all of this yellow area and the green areas are where Christianity existed. There are a couple of different flavors of Christianity then, and that's why there's different colors. But you'll notice that Georgia and Armenia, all of the Middle East, Israel and Syria, Egypt, all of North Africa, obviously the Iberian Peninsula, Spain and Portugal, Germany, all of Italy, Greece, the Balkans, all of those areas were Christian by the 6th century AD. The kingdom of the Franks had originally been a barbarian, pagan people. They're one of the ones that beat up on Rome early on. And likewise the Visigoths. But one of the astonishing things is in the 5th and 6th century AD, after conquering Rome and causing the Dark Ages and all of that, almost all of the major barbarian tribes became Christian. They all converted to Christianity, which was quite astonishing. But the point is, and the dark green line, by the way, is where the Roman Empire, that was the outline of the Roman Empire, the control of the Roman Empire in the 6th century. So Christianity extended all over North Africa, all over the Middle East and Egypt, all of Syria, all of Armenia and Georgia, the various parts of the Balkans, Western Europe, etc., as you might expect in terms of Europe. That was in the 6th century. But then, a quite astonishing thing happened. And that thing happened in the personhood of Muhammad. Muhammad was born in 570, and by the way, if there are any Muslims here, my apologies for having a picture or an artistic representation. They didn't have a lot of cameras back then. An artistic representation of Muhammad. In Islam, of course, you do not have images of people. That's why when you go in mosques, there's all the calligraphy and there's all the geometry and the beautiful designs, but no pictures of people, and very seldom even animals, because that was considered shirk. Shirk is an Islamic word which means to have anything that tries to replace God, that anything that you use is an idol. And it's believed that if you represent images of people, which is God's primary creation, you're challenging God. And there's a danger you might begin to worship those images. So Islam does not allow that. But even Islam has some exceptions for educational purposes. And since we're talking educationally, this is one artist's representation of what Muhammad might have looked like. The box in the lower right-hand corner, this is a calligraphy of Muhammad's name. And then the upper right corner represents the Quran. The Quran literally means a recitation. Muhammad was illiterate. He did not write the Quran. The Quran was, in Muslim belief, the Quran was given to him by God through the angel Gabriel, and he was told to recite it. That's what Quran, recitation, means. And other people later on wrote it down. But the Quran is considered to be, by Muslims, the absolute word of God. And actually, the correct word of God, they believe that Jews and Christians receive the word of God, but then they messed it up, and so it's corrupted. So the Quran, the word of God, recited through Muhammad, is considered to be God's true word to us. Now, Muhammad was born in 570. Islam started really about 622, so when he was about... Well, not quite 50 years old, but it started to grow in 622. And so you have this map. This is Saudi Arabia. Islam, Muhammad lived in Mecca and ended up traveling to Medina, which, Hajira, the migration. When they didn't accept him in Mecca, he went to Medina. But the point here is that between 632 and 632, all of this sort of reddish area came under the new religion, Islam, and that's during Muhammad's life. When Muhammad died, there was a disagreement as to how who would succeed him. You've heard the word caliph. The word caliph means successor, the one who succeeds or comes after Muhammad. So there was a split in terms of who would follow, and when we talk about the children of Abraham, I'll explain that, the difference between Sunni and Shia Islam. That split happened when Muhammad died because they had different ideas who should succeed him. The point is that between 632 and 750, all of this area that's shown in brown and purple was conquered by Muslim armies. Now, where is this? It is the Middle East, Georgia, Armenia, North Africa, even the Iberian Peninsula became Islamic by force of arms. There were Muslim armies, and they conquered these areas, and they were turned into Muslim areas. Now, again, this was the map toward the end of the 500s in terms of where Christianity was. North Africa, Iberian Peninsula, Egypt, Middle East, Armenia, Georgia, etc. This is what it looked like less than 200 years later, after Islam. Do you see what one of the problems were that led to the Crusades? The Christian Europe felt the pressure of the Muslim armies conquering. In fact, it wasn't until the 700s that Charles Martel, who was the grandfather of Charlemagne, you know the name Charlemagne? Charlemagne came along late 700s, 800s. But his grandfather, Charles Martel, is one of the first ones that was successful in defeating a Muslim army in Europe. They were, and let me back up here, you'll notice here, these arrows, they were almost to Paris. The Muslim armies got almost to Paris. They got to Tours in the 700s before Charles Martel and another sort of minor king defeated them and pushed them back to the border between France and what we know of as France and Spain. But they were aggressively trying to move into Western Europe. So that gives you a little bit of a perspective in terms of how Western Europe felt about Islam. They saw them as a conquering force that was seeking to take over Western Europe. Now, I'm not saying that with any bias or any prejudice. I'm saying that as a historically neutral fact. That is what happened, and that is how it was received by Western Europe. Please do not think I'm being negative about Islam. There were times, initially Christianity did not grow by force of arms. Initially, Christianity grew entirely by people wanting to accept this new religion. It was an evangelistic effort. The greatest growth in the first 300 years was before Christianity was even legal. And so they didn't have an army. You know, they weren't even technically allowed to be. Later on, like under Charlemagne in the 800s, Charlemagne did conquer areas, and he did force people to convert. So Christianity has had times like that too. But Islam, by force of arms, was converting places to their faith. And I only say that in order for you to understand that Western Europe felt threatened by that. Now, a series of various events, the events leading up to the Crusades. The first one, as I just have explained, was the birth and rapid expansion of Islam moving into areas that Christianity had previously been the predominant faith. North Africa, the Middle East, even the Iberian Peninsula, that is Spain and Portugal. That's one of the major events. Then, in 1009, so we're talking, you know, 250 years later, the Fatimid Caliph al-Hakim in Egypt, who was known as the Mad Caliph. Now, I will say, the Muslim armies, when they conquered an area and it became technically Islamic, they respected Jews and Christians and did not force them to convert. Why? Because they saw Christians and Jews as coming from the same source, that is, from Father Abraham. They were called people of the book because the Jewish Bible, the Christian Bible, Old Testament, New Testament as we call it, they saw that as being a messed up version of God's Word, but that was well intended, even though they feel like it had gotten wrong and Muhammad had straightened them out. But they respected them and didn't force them to convert. Pagans, that is people who were not Christians or Jews before they got there, the Muslim armies forced them to convert or they killed them. All right, so they were pretty aggressive. Christians and Jews, they pretty much left alone. They sometimes forced them to pay extra taxes, but they didn't force them to become Islamic. All right, so they were fair in that regard. But in 1009, the Mad Caliph, Fatima was the daughter of Muhammad. He did not have any sons that survived. He had several daughters. Fatima was his oldest daughter, and so her descendants, the Caliph of Egypt, al-Hakim, claimed to be descended from Fatima. That the whole Muslim kingdom at that point was called the Fatimid Kingdom because they thought they were descended. Well, the Mad Caliph, al-Hakim, he was mentally unstable. Everybody in history now, I think, recognizes that. He did persecute Jews and Christians. That was rare. He forced conversions. He denied religious holidays to anyone who was not Islamic. You couldn't celebrate Christmas or Hanukkah or anything else. He began destroying religious sites. For instance, he destroyed the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. And so this was a huge deal. and he obviously prevented pilgrims from visiting that part of the world. The previous Muslim authorities had allowed Christians and Jews to continue to live and to visit the Christian sites. So Al-Hakim created a huge problem. Then in 1021, the Byzantine Empire, which I'll tell you about in a little while, and we'll talk about that under the Birthplace of Empires talk, the Byzantine Empire took over responsibility to protect those shrines. They were allowed to come in. They actually rebuilt the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in 1048. If you visit Jerusalem, I'm sure you will visit the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. The Byzantine Christians rebuilt that in 1048 after it had been destroyed. We then end up, shortly after that, in 1040, a group comes along. Now, at this point, you notice that Muhammad was from Arabia. All of the leaders, including the Fatimid caliphs and all of the others, and there were several different sort of empires, if you will, that came out of Islam. It was not one monolithic kind of thing. I recently overheard someone having a conversation, and they said, well, you know, Christianity is really complicated, but Islam is really simple. You know, anybody can understand, Islam is just really simple. No, it's not. It's no more simple than Christianity is. There have been various movements, various rulers, various, you know, things going on. Shia and Sunni have always been at war with one another, and so it's complicated as well. But all of the leaders up until the 11th century were all Arabic. In the 11th century, a group came out of Central Asia, actually from what we used to call the Stans, all right? You ever wonder where Turkey gets its name? And the Turks? You ever heard of Turkmenistan? The Seljuk Turks migrated out of Central Asia through Persia, and they sort of settled in Persia, and then in the 11th century, they ended up defeating the Ghaznavid Empire, which was a Persian empire, and Persian Islamic empire, and they took over. At that point, the main caliph of Islam, who was located in Baghdad at that point, invited them to come and help him fight against the Shia Muslims, because they were Sunni. Well, the Seljuk Turks come in, and in very short order, they take over. Technically, there was still a caliph in charge, but they really were the power behind the throne. And that's where the Seljuk Turks start taking over. And then the Turks are there. They're beginning to take over more land by military conquest. They start moving into what we know as Turkey, what was called Anatolia or Asia Minor. And then, big deal, on July 16th, we know the exact date of 1054, we have what's called the Great Schism, or sometimes the Western Schism, the split between Eastern Orthodoxy and Western Roman Catholic Christianity. This split was very significant in terms of the history of the church. This map shows you what, after 1054, were the two halves of Christianity. The green is Roman Catholic Christianity. The yellow is Orthodox Christianity, and of course all the rest of this is Islam, all right? It's the Muslim areas. There were a number of differences between the East and the West in terms of their religious beliefs. It was all Christendom at one point, but over a period of time they developed a difference. In the West, that is Europe, based in Rome with the Pope, they spoke Latin, their services were in Latin. In the East, they spoke Greek. They began to develop different liturgical issues. How they dealt with icons, that is religious imagery, was very different. And some of the things we look at today and we think, well, how silly was that? They fought over whether or not you could use leavened or unleavened bread in communion. That was a big deal to them. The issue of whether priests could marry. In Western Christianity in Europe, priests were not allowed to marry. Eastern priests could marry. Bishops couldn't, but priests could. There was also the issue of what's called the Filioque. You know the Nicene Creed, the first great creed of the church, which came out of the first council of the church in Nicaea in the early 300s. The Nicene Creed was the first real statement of faith that the Christian church had. And one of the statements in the Nicene Creed is, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father. That's the way it read originally. Nicaea is in Turkey. It was an eastern city. When the Western church took over the Nicene Creed, they added something to it. In the West, the statement said, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. That "and the Son" in Latin is filioque. And so filioque is that expression. The East went nuts when they found out that the West had added something to the Nicene Creed. And they said, the Holy Spirit doesn't proceed from the Son. It just proceeds from the Father. These things, which don't sound like huge deals to us, created constant pressure. Much of it was political. Originally, there had been five major centers of Christianity. Those had been Jerusalem, Alexandria in Egypt, Antioch in Syria, Constantinople, and Rome. What happened to the first three of those? Alexandria, Jerusalem, and Antioch. They're controlled by Muslims now. They're no longer centers of the Christian faith. All that leaves is Constantinople and Rome. Rome had been the original center, the capital of the Roman Empire. But in the early 300s, when Constantine the Great, when he became emperor, he moved the capital from Rome to the city of Byzantium. He renamed it New Rome because it was now the capital of the whole Roman Empire. Well, people accuse him of being immodest by renaming it Constantinople. Historically, Constantine didn't name the city Constantinople. He named it New Rome, but his followers all started calling it Constantinople and it stuck. All right? So Constantinople was the new capital, and they felt like we're the new capital of the Roman Empire. We therefore are the capital of the Christian world. Rome still said, no, we're the original capital, and so therefore we're the center of the Christian world. The Pope in Rome, the Patriarch of the Eastern Church in Constantinople, each one thought they should be in charge. And so much of what happened there, it was political. In 1054, the Pope in Rome sent representatives to Constantinople to tell them, you guys got to get in line and acknowledge that I'm the one in charge of the Christian Church. Well, the Patriarch in Constantinople and the Emperor in Constantinople said, not so much. So the fairly gruff representatives of the Pope immediately excommunicated the Patriarch of Constantinople and excommunicated the Emperor. The very next day, the Emperor and the Patriarch announced that the Pope in Rome is excommunicated. All right? Anybody that, you know, moved too quick was going to get excommunicated at that point. So that caused a split between Eastern or Orthodox Christianity and Western or Catholic Christianity. And that happened in 1054. Now, in 1055, the Seljuk Turks, the Muslim armies, start infringing more and more into Asia Minor, headed toward Constantinople. Because Constantinople is right there, right in between Turkey and what we know of as Greece. The city straddles Asia and Europe, literally, on the Bosphorus, which is that thin body of water there. If you've never been to Constantinople, go! Plan it! Get off this boat, get on a plane, go to Constantinople. It is really worth the trip. The Hagia Sophia, which was built in the 500s, the most astonishing Christian church ever, I believe. More so than St. Peter's to me. When the Turks took over, they turned it into a mosque until the 1920s, in which it was turned into a museum. Because when Ataturk wanted to bring the Turkish Republic into the 20th century, he said, having one of the most important churches in all of Christian history, a mosque probably is not going to be is not taken very well by the West. So they turned it into a museum so it was neutral. Okay. Anyway, you've got the split now between Eastern and Western Christianity, and they're not getting along. Then in 1071, the Seljuk Turks defeat the Byzantine army at the Battle of Manzikert, and that opens the way for the Muslims to begin to take over all. At that point, the Byzantine army was no longer powerful enough to keep the Turks from moving in. So they slowly just started occupying what we know of as Turkey, Asia Minor. And it was becoming more and more Muslim at that point. And when they did that, they cut off, well, they captured the Byzantine emperor, for one thing, and then they cut off access to the Holy Land to Christians. They kept getting closer and closer and closer to Constantinople until, in 1095, the emperor of Constantinople, actually the Roman emperor at that point, he appealed back to Rome, to the Pope, and said, help. We need more soldiers to help fight off the incursion of the Muslim armies. They've already taken over almost all of Asia Minor. It's a matter of time before they get to the walls of Constantinople. We need your help. Well, 1095 was when the Council of Clermont was being held, and Pope Urban I'll talk about in a second, says, yes, we're going to do this, and I'll talk about why. This is what the Muslim Seljuk Turk Empire looked like in 1092, right before the Byzantine Emperor asked for help. This was where the Seljuk Turks defeated the previous Muslim Empire. This is Baghdad, which was the center of the Seljuk Empire after that. This is where Manzikert, you'll notice it's sort of on the way to Turkey, Asia Minor, ancient Anatolia. By 1092, Constantinople is sitting there with Muslim armies right outside the walls. And that was the point at which the Byzantine emperor called for help. Now, so the reasons for the Crusades, that's all sort of background. There are a number of reasons why the Crusades happened. The first one is in response to the Byzantine emperor's request for help against the Muslim armies. They're right outside the gates. Come and help. And Western Christendom felt the responsibility to go and help these other Christians against the armies of Islam. Now, it's important to note that initially, neither the emperor in Byzantium, in Constantinople, nor the Pope had any plans of taking the Holy Land away from the Muslims. That wasn't the plan. That wasn't what was asked for by the emperor, and that wasn't what the Pope planned to do. What was asked for and what the Pope planned to do was to send armies to help defend Constantinople. When they decided, the emperor and the Pope agreed that they were going to work together on this, the Pope encouraged preachers, Christian preachers, monks and itinerant preachers to go out and preach this to raise an army. And apparently the Pope expected to get a few thousand. Well, these preachers started going out and preaching, and they got enthusiastic about this, and everybody started liking this idea, and they got more. Before you know it, they were preaching that we're going to take Jerusalem back away from the Muslims. That was not what the Pope wanted. That was not what the Byzantine Emperor asked for. Well, between those itinerant preachers coming up with this idea and selling that to everybody, and then the actual crusaders, once they started deciding our goal is to take back Jerusalem, not just defend Constantinople, then it became a big deal. It's also true that the Pope expected a few thousand people to show up. Well, he ended up with 100,000 people in the First Crusade. Nobody thought that was going to happen. And it really scared the Byzantine Emperor to death when all these people showed up, and he had to feed them before they went from there. Okay. In fact, one of the things that the Emperor of Constantinople said when they showed up is, any lands that you do take, and he was thinking Asia Minor at first, any of those lands you take, you have to give them back to me. And he made them swear an oath to him to give back the land. And at first they said, no, we're not going to do it. He said, fine, then I'm not giving you anything to eat. And when they got hungry enough, they finally agreed that they would pledge to the emperor. He fed them, provided for them, and then they went out. When they started winning battles in Asia Minor, they just kept going until they got to the Holy Land. Okay, so one of the things is response to a request for help. Secondly, it was to defend Christian Europe against further Muslim invasion. The Iberian Peninsula, Spain and Portugal, had been controlled by the Muslim armies since the 700s. So they'd been pretty well established once they were beaten back out of France. It's not like they had just moved in there, but the fear was that if they continued to be successful in the east, taking over Asia Minor and Constantinople, etc., then they would be encouraged to also start up again in terms of trying to invade Western Europe. So there was this kind of pincher thing going on. So idea was stop them at Constantinople, keep them from growing any further in Western Europe at the same time. And so this idea of preventing the spread of Islam into Europe, okay? And we'll talk about the Western Europe thing as well. A third and fourth kind of goals which go together were the hopes of reuniting the two halves of Christendom. It was only 40 years before this that Christianity had split in two. And there was a lot of desire on the part of the church to try to get them back together. We should be one Christendom. Christendom is the sort of geographic unity of the Christian faith in the old days. And so there was a desire to get the two halves of Christendom back together, and they thought this might be a chance to do it. But particularly, Pope Urban II, he felt like if we go and help the Emperor of Constantinople, then we'll be the heroes, and they'll acknowledge that I am in charge of all of Christendom. So there was a political motivation. The popes were very big on having their power recognized. So that was part of what the motivation was, is that he could be in charge. In fact, there was one point when it got really bad when the emperor and the patriarch told the bishop of Rome, the pope, if you'll come and help, we will acknowledge you as being the primate of the entire Christian faith, Eastern and Western, all right? Then there was a sense in which they were to defend the holy sites, the Christian holy sites and pilgrims. Remember that it was less than 100 years before that that the mad caliph, Al-Hakim, had been destroying churches and shrines that the Christians held holy, like the Church of the Holy Sepulcher. Then there was a desire on the part of the Pope to focus the energy of Western knights away from internal fighting. If you know anything about history, you'll know that one of the biggest problems that you have if you have an army, and this is true throughout history, is you have an army with nothing to do. All right? Because they get in trouble. They start looking for something to do, and what are they trained to do? They're trained to fight. That had been happening with knights in Western Europe. These knights were trained to fight. They didn't have anybody to fight, so they were picking on little people. They were stealing from peasants. They were, you know, taking over towns. And the church had instituted several different efforts to try to stop this. What's called the Peace of God and the Truce of God. The Peace of God was a list of all the people that the knights, if they were going to be okay with the church, all the people the knights couldn't pick on. All right? Peasants, women, children, you know, the poor, monks. You can't mess with them, because if you do, the church will excommunicate you. They also had a thing called the Truce of God, which told them when they couldn't fight. You can't fight on Sunday. You can't fight during holy days. No fighting during Lent. So the church had really been working hard to try to control these knights. Well, this gave them something to do, something that they thought was a right thing to do, and that is defend Christendom from the armies of Islam, to defend the holy places in Israel. Okay? There was also a sense in which the Western Christianity, remember, this is right at the end of the first millennium. So much of Christianity thought that Jesus was going to come back in the year 1000. And when he didn't come back at 1000, they thought, well, maybe he'll come back at 1100. The belief had gone around that Jesus would not return until two things happened. One, Christians controlled the Holy Land, so that when Jesus came back, he'd be able to land amongst friends. And the second thing was, all the Jews had to become Christians, or else become dead. They either had to convert to Christianity, all the Jews, or they needed not to be around. Which is why a number of the Crusades, when they traveled through Europe toward the Holy Land, they persecuted Jewish people along the way and killed a great many of them. Because they were trying to force them to convert. If they didn't convert, they were killing them. Why? Because they thought, you have to be Christian or Jesus won't come back, you Jews. All right? It sounds a little crazy to us, but that's how they felt. And because this was a spiritual issue, as I told you, it was kind of like a pilgrimage and a military campaign at the same time, two other things happened. One, salvation, in effect, was promised to anyone who fought and died in the Crusades in defense of Christianity. This was where the concept of the plenary indulgence was invented. You know what a plenary indulgence is? They still give them today. In fact, we saw an article recently that apparently the Vatican will award plenary indulgences via Twitter. Not making this up. If you have done the other things necessary, if you confessed your sins and done penance for it and everything else, then the indulgence can come via Twitter. But the plenary indulgence is basically the Pope saying you do not have to spend any time, or you have to spend less time in purgatory. Having your purgatory to the Catholic Church is where you go to get scrubbed up really good before you're ready for heaven. Okay, and I'm not being frivolous. I'm sorry if it sounds frivolous. It's a serious thing, but that is the doctrine. And so knights were told, if you fight for Christendom, you receive a plenary indulgence. You don't have to spend time in purgatory. Your salvation is assured. And if you die, you know, you're good to go. Not a problem. There also, and this is the thing most people thought was the real point, to some of the knights and the others who went, and 10% of the people who went on campaign were on crusade were knights. Most of them were support staff. But they were told that some people thought, we'll go there, we can gain lands, we can gain riches. This happened more in the later crusades. But this was very limited. Most people think they went there in order to get rich. For most of the people who went on crusade, this was a very expensive proposition for them. Imagine how expensive it would be to have horses and servants and wagons and carts move across all of Europe through Asia Minor to get to the Holy Land on foot, by, you know, with horses and carts. Most of the people who were knights, they either sold everything they had or they mortgaged everything they had, and they left knowing that it was very possible somebody else was going to take their land and maybe even take their wives, if their wives didn't go with them. Often they did. It was a very expensive, very risky thing. This was not a cavalier. A lot of people have the idea that a bunch of Western knights, for religious prejudice, acted like a bunch of drunken frat boys and decided they were going to go to the Holy Land to kick some Muslim butt. That was not what this was about. It was a very harsh thing for most of these people to do this, all right? And yet most people have that misunderstanding. For most of the people that went, it was an act of devotion. Now, we think it may have been misguided devotion, but for them it was an act of Christian devotion, whether we understand that or not. And it was a very costly thing. So let's talk about a few of the specific crusades. The major crusades, there were four major crusades, four minor crusades, and then some things that happened in the West. In 1095, as I said, the Byzantine emperor pleads for help, and Pope Urban II calls for a holy war, a crusade to take up the cross. And it so happened, when he received that word, they were in a church council. A bunch of the church people were together at the Council of Clermont. This is an image that was painted at the Council of Clermont. This was in November of 1095. Pope Urban, at the very end, they didn't even make this a major theme of this council, but at the very end of the council, the Pope told people, the Emperor in Constantinople has asked for us to come to defend Constantinople, and Urban II said, and I believe Deus vult, God wills it, for us to defend Christendom against Islam in Constantinople. And so, he named August 15th of the following year, so 8 months later, as the date at which they were going to leave. And he expected, again, there were going to be 1,000 or 2. Well, no sense at all that the goal was going to be to conquer Jerusalem. No sense at all that they were going to get all these people. But these itinerant preachers started preaching this thing throughout Western Europe and really drumming up a lot of enthusiasm. In fact, they drummed up so much enthusiasm that the first thing that happened early in 1096 is that a bunch of peasants got together. There were a few military people, a few knights, but most of them were just peasants. This is called the Peasants' Crusade, or the People's Crusade sometimes. In April of 1096, they leave Western Europe on foot, mostly with, you know, spades and mattocks, and, you know, they didn't even have swords. They march across Europe under the leadership of a monk called Peter the Hermit of Amiens. They travel across Europe, sacking towns as they go. They had no discipline because there were no military, there's no sense of military order. They persecuted Jews, again with this weird idea that Jews had to either become Christians or all be killed for Jesus to come back. When they got to the border of Hungary, the Hungarian king refused them passage because he thought, he'd already heard these people are making a mess everywhere they go. When they tried to force their way across, the armies of Hungary killed a lot of them. The ones that escaped that continued on. They got to Constantinople. The emperor in Constantinople said, "Who the heck are you people? You're not what I asked for. What am I supposed to do with you?" And they said, "Feed us." And so he said, "Okay, I'll give you some food if you'll leave." So they left, went into Turkey, what we know as Turkey, got to the city of Nicaea, where the first council of the church was, and there they were massacred by the Muslim armies. Okay, very bad start to the whole thing. That's not technically one of the crusades, but that's how it all got started. It did not bode well. For one thing, it started off giving a very bad sense to the emperor in Constantinople. The first regular crusade, or true crusade, started in December of 1096, a little bit later than what the Pope had asked for. It was mostly Norman French, that is from northern France, and Italian. In fact, the fact that most of the early crusaders were French, the people in the Middle East, the Muslims and others, called them Franks. All of the crusaders were called Franks, no matter where they were from. The Franks were the barbarian people who settled that area, and later that's where we get the name French, from the Franks, okay? About 100,000 of them, most of those support people, not knights, leave from Europe. They travel across, or from Western Europe. They travel across Europe. They get to Constantinople, and again, this is where the emperor has them pledge to support him and to give back any land they take, because he won't feed them otherwise. They agree to that. They leave Constantinople, and they travel across. And the Turks, the Turkish armies were not very well organized then. There were various forces, and they were sort of infighting, and so they weren't very organized in providing a defense. The armies get to Antioch. They conquer Antioch, major city. Remember, Antioch was one of the major cities of the Christian world. Antioch was the third city in the Roman Empire, after Rome and Alexandria. Antioch, a major city. They conquer Antioch. They head south. In July of 1099, they conquer Jerusalem. And they set up four crusader states, sort of their own countries, if you will. The county of Edessa, the county of Tripoli, the principality of Antioch, and the kingdom of Jerusalem. This is the route of the first crusade. Again, they came from several places. They met up in Constantinople and went from there, conquered Antioch and Jerusalem. And they set up these four states. The county of Edessa, the principality of Antioch, the county of Tripoli, and the kingdom of Jerusalem. They were controlled by crusaders, crusader lords. None of these were kings where they came from, but they were nobility, some of them. This area, this whole new crusader region, was called the Outremer, which literally means the land beyond the sea. They did not keep their promise to the emperor in Constantinople. They did not give the land back. They decided, hey, it's good to be king. And so there was a king of Jerusalem, there was a king of Edessa, there was a, you know, each of them had their own ruler, and they became kings. This was the first crusade really established this. From this point on, every other major crusade was in response to some, either directly or indirectly, some response to losses in the crusader states. Something negative that happened in these crusader states. The second crusade, which was launched in 1147, was in response to the Muslim defeat of the county of Edessa in 1144. The Muslim armies came in, they defeated the county of Edessa, took it back, so one of the crusader states was destroyed. And so a second crusade was called, mostly French and South German. They travel, they didn't accomplish anything. The only thing they accomplished, again, was persecution of European Jews along the way and providing victory for some of the Muslim armies. They actually were better organized than the first crusade. They made arrangements for transit through Hungary and other places. They made arrangements for food supplies to be there. They looked like they were doing really well. But, and again, the Byzantine emperor made them swear an oath. When they got to the Holy Land, however, they were not well organized. They split up. They got defeated piecemeal. Those that survived ended up in Antioch, and they were trying to decide, okay, what should we do now? What's the best thing to do? And for reasons that nobody has ever figured out, they decide to attack Damascus. Damascus, while it had previously been a center for the Seljuk Turks, was not a major deal. Everybody else is looking at this going, Damascus? Why Damascus? And it's probably because they couldn't agree on anything, so they picked something neutral. They go to Damascus and say, we're going to conquer Damascus. They show up and realize this is a really powerfully fortified city. They park outside for 5 days and then decide, well, this isn't working, let's go home. And they break up, and the Second Crusade ends with nothing having happened. Right? This map shows all of the Crusades. The red is the First Crusade, which took these areas, and they're shown up here, the Crusader states. The green from Metz in Germany. They get here, nothing happens, okay? So that's the second campaign. We'll come back to the others in a minute. During this time, there is the rise of the most famous Muslim general of this time named Saladin. Saladin was not Arabic. He was not Turkish. He was Kurdish. You know about the Kurds? You remember Saddam Hussein used poison gas against the Kurds in the northern part of Iraq? Allegedly used poison gas. Some people say he didn't actually, but he persecuted them. Saladin was a Kurd. He was a great military mind, a great general. He also was known for being extraordinarily honest and generous and mostly merciful. The one exception to that was whenever he conquered one of the Templar Knights or the Knights of St. John, he killed them immediately because they were too dangerous, he thought. All right, so he had his rough spots too. But he had been appointed the vizier of Egypt and ended up, because of his military might, pretty much being the leader of the Muslim world because of his military ability. So you've got Saladin. Under Saladin, the Muslim armies get organized, and in 1189, another crusade starts, because in 1187, Saladin and the Muslim armies had taken Jerusalem back. Jerusalem was the gem. It was, and once they got started, it didn't start out that way, but once they got going, that was the focus of so much, was Jerusalem, the holy city at Jerusalem. So the Third Crusade started because Saladin takes back Jerusalem, and this one has been called, you know, We Three Kings Crusade, because this is the first time nobility gets involved. This one crusade, the Third Crusade, was led by King Richard I, Richard Lionheart, you may have heard of England. In fact, if you watch all the movies about Robin Hood, they're all waiting for King Richard to come back from the Holy Land, all right? Because he really did go to the Holy Land. Richard the Lionheart, King Philip II of France, and the Emperor of Germany, Frederick Barbarossa. Well, Frederick Barbarossa strikes out on his own, because he's not waiting for these other guys. The French and the English don't like each other. When have the French and English ever liked each other? Okay, can you say 100 Years' War? And so they aren't willing to move forward, either one of them, unless they coordinate with the other one, because they don't trust the other one to be by themselves. So they take a little longer, and they follow along. Actually, when Richard left England, he left by boat, and they stopped off in Portugal, and he and his troops succeeded in freeing Lisbon, the city of Lisbon, Portugal, from the Muslim armies. And then they proceeded on their way. They ended up meeting up with Philip II of France, and they end up traveling together. Well, unfortunately, Frederick Barbarossa of Germany drowns crossing a river in Anatolia, and most of his troops go back home. Some of them proceed, but for the most part, the Germans are out of it at that point. They move on, and the armies of Richard Lionheart and Philip II of France end up taking the island of Cyprus, which we're going to visit. And one of the reasons, by the way, we're doing the Crusades is yesterday you saw the Crusader fortifications in Rhodes. Those were built by the Knights of St. John, the Knights Hospitaller. I'll explain to you in a few minutes. But you're also going to see Crusader fortresses in Cyprus and various other places that we're going to be visiting. And that's why I'm doing this early on, so you'll know what you're looking at. So Richard and Philip go on, they conquer Acre, and at that point, Philip II, who was a little bit spoiled, he said, okay, that's enough. I conquered a city, I'm going home. So he goes back home, and that leaves Richard the Lionheart. And Richard and Saladin become historic opponents fighting each other. And they develop real respect for each other, even affection for each other. At one point, they're fighting a battle. Richard's horse is killed out from under him. Saladin sees this, and he sends him a horse so that Richard can have a mount for the battle, because it wasn't fair to have the king on foot during this battle. So they continue to battle. Richard is successful taking a number of cities, but is unable to take Jerusalem because of supply problems mostly. In 1192, because they were getting along so well, Richard and Saladin sign a truce. And that truce included that Saladin would allow Christian pilgrims to come to Jerusalem. So that was all good, although a lot of Christians thought Richard had betrayed them because he struck a truce with this Muslim army leader, okay? So this is the Third Crusade here. You'll notice I told you it came from England. And then they connected up. They took... they stopped at Crete, they took Cyprus back, and then got to the Holy Land. All right? I'm going to have to talk faster. Fourth Crusade. The Fourth Crusade is the last major crusade I'm going to mention. It never makes it to the Holy Land. What happens is, a bunch of these crusaders get in 1202, and they decide, hey, the biggest problem these people have had is they've been trying to march across Europe and Anatolia. We're going to take a boat, you know? Well, the naval power of that time was Venice. And Venice, which was a city-state, an independent city-state, not part of another country, they were a major sea power. So the crusaders go to Venice and they say, take us to the Holy Land. And they go, look, it's going to take a while to build that many boats. Give us 2 years, and this is between 1202 and 1204. Give us 2 years, we'll build enough boats to carry all of your crusaders, which they at that point they thought they were going to have 35,000 crusaders, and you pay us, and we'll take you. 2 years later, Venice has all the boats. The most they can muster is 11,000 crusaders, not 35,000 or so, and they don't have the money to pay for the boats. Oops. And Venice said, we already built the boats, so one way or the other, we're going to get paid for this. And they said, look, we'll postpone our payment if you will help us, you military crusader guys, will go with us, we'll take you by sea, and help us reconquer the city of Zadar in Croatia, because about 15 years earlier, Zadar previously had been owned by Venice, and they had broken off and been independent. It was a very wealthy city. The Pope hears about this, and he sends word to the crusader leaders that if you guys attack a Christian city, which it was, then I'm going to excommunicate you. But the head of the crusaders, who really wanted to go, didn't bother to tell everybody else that. So they get in the boats, the Venetians take them to Zadar, they conquer it in about a month, and then they stay for a number of months in Zadar, and by that time the Pope says, well, okay, if you're really going to go to the Holy Land, I won't bother you. They leave, and with them they have a guy named Alexius the Younger. Alexius had been the son of the Emperor of Constantinople, the Byzantine Emperor. His father had been deposed and blinded and put in prison. Well, Alexius was a very charming young guy. He went to the Crusaders and said, will you help me get my father out of prison and reestablish him as the rightful ruler? And they said, sure. Because Alexius said, in return for that, I'll pay for all your provisions, I'll give you 200,000 silver marks, and I'll give you 10,000 soldiers to help you fight the battle. I go, good deal, we'll do it. So they go to Constantinople, they attack Constantinople, actually set it on fire, and so the ruler leaves. Alexius the Younger's father is let out of prison, they put him back on the throne, and then it turns out that Alexius and his father don't have the money to pay them. Oops. All right? And so the crusaders do what any respectable crusader would do. They sack the city of Constantinople, the center of the Christian world. They take the city, they set up a Latin Christian state in Constantinople, and it lasted for 57 years. Well, you remember one of the motivations for the Crusades was to try to bring the East and West back together, the Eastern Church and Western Church?
Yeah.
What do you think that did when Western Christian knights attacked the center of the Eastern world, Constantinople, conquer it, and take it over? The division between East and West at that point was absolute. They were not going to get back together after this, all right? They stay there for 57 years. The split between East and West is complete, and later on Constantinople managed to free themselves from the Latin crusaders. So, this fourth crusade is fairly short. From Venice to Croatia, and then to Constantinople, they never even got to the Holy Land. This is another map of all of the different crusades. You can see it was a pretty busy place for 200 years. The last or final crusades, there were four more crusades to the east, the 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th. They didn't accomplish anything except get a lot of people killed. In 1270, King Louis IX of France, this is St. Louis. You ever been to St. Louis, Missouri? St. Louis, Missouri is named after him. San Luis Potosi, for those of you from Mexico, San Luis Potosi is named after him. He was a saint of the church. He was a very godly man. He did this as an act of devotion. Unfortunately, he didn't win anything. His army mostly died of disease. He himself died in North Africa. In 1289, the Crusader County of Tripoli, the last of the Crusader states, is defeated. And in 1291, the city of Acre falls, and all of the Crusaders are driven out of the Middle East. Okay? And the Crusades to the East end, with nothing having been gained. In fact, quite the contrary, as we'll talk about, there was a division now between Eastern and Western Christianity. There were hard feelings between Islam and Christianity that could not be resolved. Pretty bad scene. There then were a number of Western or minor crusades. 1193, there were northern crusades. The Pope called for crusades against pagans in Germany and Northern Europe to force them to convert. The Teutonic Knights, I'm going to mention in just a minute. I'm going to take 10 extra minutes. Am I okay with that, Travis? Okay. 1208, the Albigensian Crusades in southern France and Bosnia. Albigensianism was a Christian heresy, according to the church. They actually were dualistic. They believed powers of good and evil were equal in fighting. And so they tried to force them to convert, and the ones who didn't convert, they killed them. This was a crusade called by the Pope. Then in 1212, you have the Children's Crusade, a little child shall lead them kind of idea. They actually start a group of children, start gathering street urchins and orphans and other children, and they actually march across Europe and get to the coast, and the young man, early teenager, who was leading them said, God has told me when we get to the coast he will provide boats. Well, they got to the coast and there were no boats. So it all sort of dispersed. There's a legend that they were all massacred. Actually, they weren't. They just didn't get anywhere. 1212 to 1492 is the period of the Reconquista. The 10th Crusade, as it's sometimes called, was the effort to retake Spain from the Muslims. This actually, as I told you, it started back in the early 700s with Charles Martel, Charlemagne's grandfather, defeating the Muslims, pushing them back. But over the period of 270 years or so, from 1212 to 1492, they continued to fight battles and push the Muslim forces back further and further. The last of the Muslim strongholds in Spain was Cordoba, Granada. Have you been to Granada? The beautiful Alhambra in Granada. That was the last Muslim empire or Muslim center in Western Europe. And they pushed them back into North Africa. Now, the interesting thing was that when they took over Spain from the Muslims, they discovered all of this brilliant learning. The Muslim world was far more sophisticated, more learned, more educated than Western Europe was. Western Europe had come out of the Dark Ages. They no longer had the great writings of the Greek philosophers or scientists like Aristotle. They didn't understand Arabic numerals. The Arabic numerals actually came from India, but the Arabic peoples had refined them, and that made mathematics possible. Okay? You know Roman numerals, right? Mm-hmm. Challenge for you. Write down three Roman numerals and try to add them up. It doesn't work. You cannot do that. Well, they were using Roman numerals in Western Europe. When they reconquered Spain, the libraries that were left behind by the Moors, the Muslims in Spain, Al-Andalusia it was called, when they left, they rediscovered all these great famous writings. The philosophers of Greece, the writings of Aristotle, the numerical systems, the concept of zero. They had no concept of zero in Western Europe until they retook the Arabic centers in Spain. Can you imagine doing mathematics without a zero? All right? It was huge. What happened when they, and then we began to develop the sciences and everything else out of the seeds of the Arabic cultures that were left behind when Islam was driven out of the Iberian Peninsula. Well, it continued in the 1250, this is what it looked like around Constantinople. This was the Ottoman Empire, which was the successor to the Seljuk Turks. The Karamanid Emirate was another Muslim empire. This little area here, this is Constantinople. That purple and the Peloponnesian Peninsula of Greece were the only parts that remained by the mid-1400s of the Byzantine Empire. You had the Venetians, remember the greedy Venetians? They controlled Crete, a number of other islands. Cyprus was its own kingdom. You had the Knights of St. John. We were just on Rhodes. That's Rhodes. The Knights of St. John that built all of those fortifications, they controlled a number of islands. And there were a few other, you know, minor ones. But the Ottoman Empire had taken over virtually everything. Constantinople and a small piece of property, all that was left. And by the time of this map, the lighter colors here, show how far Islam had gone in the Ottoman Empire by the 1600s. We think of Islam, Muslim, as being, you know, Middle East, Arabia. The city of Venice, there were a number of times that the armies of Islam were right outside the city of Venice. They controlled all of Turkey, all of Bulgaria, all of Greece, Armenia, all of those areas during the Ottoman Empire were controlled by Islam. They were technically Islamic countries. Then, by the First World War, before the First World War, it was pushed back so that this darker area here and then Anatolia or Turkey as we know it, and these areas were all that the Ottoman Empire was called the sick old man of Europe because they really had problems at that point. I'm going to spend a couple minutes and talk about the military orders. The military orders were basically monks with swords because they were people who committed themselves to a monastic lifestyle. That is, they took vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. But part of the discipline was a martial discipline or a military discipline. They started out defending pilgrims. Remember I said that one of the things that was a motivation for the crusade was to allow pilgrims to get to Christian sites. The military orders, the Knights Templar and others, were the first of the orders that were like monks, but they were supposed to protect people. So they were warriors as well. There were three primary or major orders. There were smaller ones, and those were the Knights Templar, the Knights of St. John, and the Teutonic Knights. I'll talk about those a little bit. The Knights Templar, technically their name is the Knights of the Temple of Solomon, because when they started, and these guys started in the 1100s, 1129, not too long after the First Crusade, they were stationed, or headquarters, in the Solomon's Temple in Jerusalem. They were also called the Poor Fellow Soldiers of Christ and the Temple of Solomon. They, over a period of time, became very wealthy, not personally. They personally had no wealth at all, but as an order. They were so successful militarily, and everybody respected them so much. Bernard of Clairvaux, you know, the start of the Cistercian order in Europe, was a big advocate. He really pitched these guys. A lot of people would donate property to them and donate goods to them, and they became very wealthy. In fact, the banking system in Europe started with the Templars. Because what happened is they became so rich and so widespread, if you were a knight or a person going on crusade, you'd go to the local Templars and say, here's all my money, and they would give you a receipt. When you got to Israel or the Holy Land, when you got wherever you were going, you go to the Templars there and go here, and they'd give you money. They invented checks. And they became so wealthy, the Templars, and so successful as a military order as well. I told you that Saladin, when they captured Templars, or the other knights as well, he immediately killed them because they were too dangerous. One knight Templar was considered the equal to 10 or 20 other soldiers, because this was a religious thing for them. They had this fervor of their faith that they were fighting for. And so they became so wealthy, and they loaned money to everybody in Europe. And they built all these wonderful palaces and temples and everything. If you saw the Knights of St. John, the palace of the Grand Master of the Knights of St. John yesterday on Rhodes. Well, this is what ended up eventually leading to their downfall, because King Philip of France borrowed so much money from them, he knew he couldn't pay it back. And so, because he was very powerful politically, and he sort of had the Pope under his thumb, Philip of France convinced the Pope that he needed to get rid of the Templars. Because if he got rid of the Templars, he got rid of Philip's debt to the Templars. So in 1307, Philip convinced the Pope to suppress the Templars. And this is, by the way, the red cross on the white is the Templars. That's their sign. To suppress them, the head and all the others were arrested. The ones in Portugal and a few other places changed their name, and they still existed. They were all arrested. In fact, they were arrested on Friday the 13th, which is the day Carol and I were born. But Friday the 13th, the tradition, it's not actually a fact, but the tradition has been, the reason Friday the 13th is an unlucky day is that's the day the Templars were suppressed. They arrested them. A couple of years, they were tried for idolatry and heresy and homosexuality and anything else that Philip could think of. The leaders were burned alive at the stake. And completely suppressed. They confiscated all their property and gave it to, guess who?
Philip.
All right? Or whoever the ruler was in the particular country. When Jacques de Molay, have you heard of the Order of de Molay? It's related to the Masonic Order. De Molay, Jacques de Molay, was the head of the Templars when they were suppressed. He and others were burned at the stake. And when de Molay was tied to the stake, he said this: God knows who is wrong and who has sinned. Soon a calamity will occur to those who have condemned us to death. A month later, Pope Clement was dead. Within the year, Philip was killed in a hunting accident. So, the Templars went away. There have been many efforts to try to reclaim that name, but the Templars no longer exist. And again, they were the Red Cross on white. There's also, in addition, the Knights of St. John. They're the ones that built all the things on roads. The Knights of St. John started out, they were the hospitallers, which means they had hospitals. They started out as an order whose job was to care for the sick and wounded, and especially the pilgrims to the Holy Land. They were sick and wounded. But while taking care of the sick and wounded, they ended up escorting them to when they needed to go home, or, you know, wherever they were going. Well, by escorting them, they ended up being more militarized, and they ended up being a fighting force as well. And they ended up building some of the most spectacular fortresses ever. You saw some yesterday. The Knights of St. John were the white cross on black. And you, if you saw, you know what a Maltese cross is? You know, it's a cross that flares, and it's even four legs. Either on a black field, which is like what you see on his chest, or on a red field. The Knights of St. John, when the Crusades left the Holy Land, they ended up on Cyprus. They got thrown off Cyprus. They came to Rhodes. They became the Knights of Rhodes. They ended up being defeated by Muslim navies of Suleiman and thrown off roads. They went to Malta, and that became their center for a long time. And so the Maltese cross is also called the cross of St. John, because that was the symbol of the Knights of St. John, or the Knights Hospitaller. Okay. The third order of any consequence, and not nearly as big as the other two, are the Teutonic Knights, which were, as you might expect, Germanic in their origin. They were technically called the Orders of the Brothers of the German House of St. Mary in Jerusalem. They were formed at the end of the 12th century. They fought in the Holy Land for a while, but then they went back to Europe, and they were part of the Western Crusades. They were used in the Crusades against non-Christians, the Prussian Crusade it was called. So they fought against pagans in Europe on behalf of the church. Napoleon Bonaparte actually outlawed this order in the 1800s. And this is what they look like. They were a black cross on a white background. So you now know what those represent. Last thing I'm going to tell you, the Knights of St. John more than any others, but the Templars also, the Teutonic Knights a little bit, they built these fortresses, like what you saw, like what you will see. All over Eastern Europe, Turkey, and the Holy Land. This is a sort of a ruin. You'll see these everywhere in the Holy Land. This is in Upper Galilee in Israel. This is Montfort Castle. Markov Castle in Syria was a castle of the Hospitallers. And one of the most extraordinary castles ever built was the Croix des Chevaliers. And in fact, as you can read here, T.E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia, he described Croix des Chevaliers as being the best preserved and most holy, admirable castle in the world. It could hold 2,000 men and all their horses and everything else. And there are places in which the walls of this castle are 100 feet thick. Oh. It is a very substantial castle, okay? A very substantial, you know, anything. On Cyprus, you will see Kyrenia Castle and other fortifications that the knights were responsible for. And I will finish by saying, I listed already all the reasons for the Crusades. Response to the emperor, Byzantine emperor's request for help to defend against further Muslim invasion, to reunite the two halves of Christendom, to establish the authority of the Pope, and all these reasons. And finally, the one that most people think is the reason was because of to make money, to take the land from somebody else, and for gain. This is an image of what... back up. What happened to the... Hang on. Okay. I forgot how I did this. The myths about the Crusades. One, the myth that most people think the Crusades were simply religious prejudice and intolerance that spilled over into violence. I've told you, look at the maps in the 500s and the maps in the late 700s, and you see what part of the reason was. There were a lot of political and religious reasons and issues of Christendom and Western Europe defending itself. Another myth is that the Crusaders did it for money. Most of them lost everything in order to do this. Many of them even their lives, like St. Louis of France. This is what most people think the Crusaders were like. This is probably what they were really like. It was expensive, and they lost everything in many cases. It was hard, there was sickness, there was obviously war. It was a very difficult thing. A third myth is that the plan all along was to conquer the Holy Land in Israel. It wasn't. That was not what the intention was. That's not what the Byzantine emperor asked for. It was not what the Pope, Urban, thought was going to happen. This just sort of developed as they went along. It was a grassroots kind of movement in that regard. Also, a myth is that the Muslims were noble in the face of Christian atrocities, or that the Christians were noble in the face of Muslim atrocities. There were atrocities on both sides. There was nobility on both sides. And we have record of that. Each side, at various times, would conquer a city and kill everyone. When the Crusaders took Jerusalem, they killed everyone in it. Later on, when the Islamic forces took Acre, they killed everyone in it. As I told you, Saladin, if he ever caught any of the knights, they were killed immediately, even if everybody else was going to be turned loose. It was war, and this was war a long time before the Geneva Conventions. All right? They didn't have the same standards. There's always a danger when you look back in history that we take our value system and try to apply it back then and go, what was wrong with those people? Well, they weren't like us because they lived 800 years ago, all right? And the idea that all of Christendom was united against Muslim and Jewish people. The Byzantine Christians from the very start and the Western Christians they were at each other's throats. You know, the Western Christians conquered Constantinople, for heaven's sake. There was not a unified front in either side. We have this idea that Christianity was this monolithic thing and Islam was this monolithic thing. No, there were all sorts of different schisms and bits and pieces of it. The consequences of the Crusades. One, it did halt, at least for a while, the growth of Islam. It's pushed Islam out of Western Europe. It stopped it for a while in Constantinople, although eventually the Ottoman Empire did grow in the East. It ended up being the final split between Eastern and Western Christianity, and they've never reconciled since then. You know, there are very few pictures ever taken now, but with the Pope from Rome and the Patriarch of Constantinople, the two heads of the Western and Eastern Church. There is a hard wall between them now. It did, however, a positive, it reestablished trade between the East and the West. All of these people from Western Europe who not only discovered all this learning of mathematics and philosophy and medicine and all that from the Arab peoples, but they went there and they discovered things like pomegranates, you know, and various kinds of food and spices and different ways of dressing and everything else. They brought a lot of that stuff back to Western Europe, and smart merchants said, you know what? I think if we went and got more of this stuff, people would pay for it. And so trade began to be shared. Cultures started being shared. Even though there was conflict between the political entities and the religious entities, people are making money, they're going to do things. All right. And so we had a lot of sharing in that regard. There was, in Europe, a clarification of European culture at this point. What that meant was the French and the Spanish and the Germans and the Italians all saw themselves as just us. Well, this was a case where many different countries joined together to do something, whether it was the right thing to do or not. And so they had a sense in which we are a European entity. There is some sense in which we are together in this thing. All right, the EU is sort of a long-term result of the coordination that they had at that time. There was the launch of a Western spirit of exploration. They visited these lands. They were fascinating and interesting. Great stuff there. Well, there might be more interesting things than, say, North Africa. Or, you know, 1492, at the end of the Reconquista, is obviously when Columbus discovered America. There was a move to discover other new places. Much of it came out of the experience of crossing over into the very exotic lands of the East. There also was a clarification of papal authority, in some ways a limitation of papal authority, but the papal authority was clarified in this, and, as you obviously could tell, a long-term enmity between Christianity and Islam. You can't use the word crusade today without people sympathetic to Islam, you know, taking offense by it. That's the story of the Crusades. Any questions? Oh, I've gone way long. I am so sorry, Travis. Wind me up and turn the loop.